since that is being shared, you know, for free on this film. I don't want to cover too much of that, but let me start and open with this. If you're interested in seeing the story of how I got into the martial arts, if you want to see that, if you go online and you type in "The Dragon Revealed," it'll bring it up. It'll bring up, you know, the trailers. It'll bring up the first part, which you can watch for free. Just type in "The Dragon Revealed." It's on YouTube. Little Light Studios. If you type that in, littlelightstudios.tv, their homepage will allow you to watch, you know, the first part of the film. It's an hour and 15 minutes long. The first part, or the first disc, we made free because we want people to be able to see the power of the Lord and what He did. And we also made it separate from the second half because we want it to be available so that it can be watched by any age group. Some of the stuff in the second disc that we'll have ready within the next couple of weeks is not really appropriate for young children. I wouldn't want, you know, anybody under probably, you know, 10 years old, you know, watching, just because they're not going to be able to comprehend what we're talking about, and it's a little bit more, what's the word I'm looking for? We have to show some of what was involved in the martial arts, so I wouldn't want to put that in front of a young person's, you know, eyes. But that first disc, you know, is for free. So if you watch that, or if you want to see it there, I've got maybe one or two left with me. I'd be happy to give to somebody if you don't have access to the internet. Please come and let me know. Yes, ma'am.
What was the website again?
Littlelightstudios.tv. They're a very strong Seventh-day Adventist ministry that have been doing good films to help reveal, you know, the dangers that are out there for quite a while. The name of the film is actually called The Dragon Revealed. The Dragon Revealed. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But anyway, when I got involved in the martial arts, I think part of it was because I was looking for direction, and I was looking for something that could give me some sort of control in my life. And I know a lot of times young people, especially if they're lacking a strong Christian role model, a father figure in their life, they're looking for that. You know, I came to church and I just didn't see, because the devil had blinded me. I didn't see things that would help me in my personal life with the struggles that I was having. So when I got involved in martial arts, you know, one of the things that my mother, you know, wanted was she wanted to be able to find a place where she could feel comfortable with. So we found a quote unquote Christian martial arts school. And, you know, 30 years ago, that would have been something that people would laugh about. And now they're everywhere. They're everywhere. You open up your phone book and call them and find out, is this a Christian school? Is the instructor a Christian? And they'll say yes. Many of them will say yes. Not all, but many of them. Unfortunately, now they're bringing the martial arts and Tai Chi and yoga into churches now, not just other churches, into our denomination, into our churches. It's being taught. It's being promoted. My mom and her husband, they go to a Seventh-day Adventist church right in Blue Ridge, Georgia, you know, an hour and 15 minutes from here. And back a few years ago, they brought in a Tai Chi teacher, and they were having classes for Tai Chi, for relaxation and for health, right there in the Seventh-day Adventist church. They didn't know. They didn't have any idea, you know, what the word Tai Chi even means or what the word yoga means. I'm going to give you an example. The word yoga, and there's Christian, quote, Christian yoga studios all over this country. In India, they laugh at that. I mean, they literally get upset about that, because they say, how can you be Christian yoga? Yoga is Hindu. You can't be yoga and Christian at the same time. That's what the Hindus say. But in our country, for some reason, people have gotten this idea, or they've been lied to and made to believe that you can blend the two and make it okay. The word yoga literally means to yoke or to join to the Hindu gods. So by practicing yoga, you are practicing being joined to these Hindu spirits. And they are the ones that actually empower people, you know, when they're doing that. In the martial arts, it's the same way. When I was in it, even though I began in a quote Christian school, you know, I have no doubt that the people that were there thought that they were doing what they were doing was right, but it wasn't right by God's word. And we had many people that would come to us and, you know, and say, "This is not right. This is not in God's word." But I couldn't see it. They would tell me, but I couldn't see it. I couldn't hear it. I would point to things in Scripture and, you know, argue with them of why it was right. And it was really frustrating, I guess, for a long time, because I needed somebody to be able to show me that had been there. I had people that would come to me, whether they be, you know, a Baptist pastor or an Adventist, you know, elder, or, and they'd bring me a pamphlet, or they'd bring me some type of a little brochure and try to tell me that martial arts was wrong, but I needed more than that. I mean, I was in it. The year that the Lord delivered me, I was like a couple months away from being 25 years. So I'd spent the better half of my life training 6 days a week in this art and, you know, teaching. You know, I had a school, I had students, and, you know, for somebody to come and tell me, you need a miracle. You need the Lord to open somebody's eyes so that they can see. Yes, sir. Well, what?
It was 10 new guy along with the first out, and then, of course,
it's a. What I would like to do, and I want to be very careful how I answer this. I'm going to share with you what the Lord has shown to me. And we have lots of people that may not see it. But my goal is not, most of all, even if we disagree, it's not my purpose to argue or to, I want to show you what I found, what the Lord has revealed to me. And when you watch the film, like I said, the first film is out right now. I mean, you can, you know, go online, you can watch the whole thing for free. The second part will be ready within 2 weeks. I want to also give you my card. I've got a card here. We've got a website that it answers just about every single question that any martial artist can ever ask. And it shows you, this is what the martial arts teach. This is what the Word of God says. Here's the quotes from the founders, not from one style, but from many styles. This is what they say. This is what the Word of God says. I'm not seeing. Okay. The first thing, and I don't want there to be any pride here, so this is not, I do not at all say this in pride. Over the 24, almost 25 years I was in the martial arts, I received 7 black belts in 7 different styles. I had my first black belt was in Kung Fu. I received a black belt in full contact Chinese boxing. I had a black belt in Ishinru Karate. Had a black belt as a first level guru in Filipino stick fighting. Had a black belt in Burmese Bondo, which was another style that was sort of mixed in there. So there were many different styles, but what I found after I started training under the last grandmaster that I was under, the last grandmaster, he was a 10th dan in 2 systems of Kung Fu. He'd been in it 50 years. He asked me a question that I would never forget. I went there to train personally with him, one-on-one, and he asked me something. He said, where do all martial arts start? That's common knowledge. It's the Shaolin Temple in China. He said, so if all martial arts started at the Shaolin, why do we see such a difference in the way it's expressed? Taekwondo does all these high, flying kicks. Where you look at the Okinawan styles, it's much more emphasis on hands and low kicks below the knees, groin and down. Whether it be Shotokan or Goju-Ryu or Shorin-Ryu, it doesn't matter. He said, then you go to Southern Shaolin and it's different, and Wing Chun is different, and Jiu-Jitsu is different, and Aikido is different. He said, why do we see something so different if they all originated at Shaolin? And I told him, I said, I don't know. I said, but that's a question that's been in my mind for years. Because as I was training in the different styles, you see common threads that are woven throughout the styles. And I would say, well, this symbol is used in Aikido. It's all over Ueshiba's writings. But yet that same symbol is also used by this Chinese man that was born 200 years before him. And you saw these common threads. And so I kept diligent notes on what I was learning. I mean, for all those years. And as I kept seeing these same threads woven throughout, these questions would come to my mind. And then here this Grand Master asks me that question. What was taught at Shaolin? What was the root that was taught there? And he revealed it to me very clearly. He said, there was one thing that was taught. And he took showed me this map, and he took an E, circled it. He said, that's what was taught there. And I knew what the E symbolized. It was energy. It was chi, internal strength, or what the Japanese call ki, or the Hindus call prana. The Polynesians call it mana. In the New Age, they call it vibrational energy, or they call it oregon. It's this energy. At the Shaolin Temple, they taught in the beginning, it's physical. You go through these certain motions, you do these certain techniques, you learn self-defense. But what makes you be able to go a step farther, what makes you be able to push through that next level is this internal strength. And the internal strength, according to all the masters, regardless, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, internal strength can only be obtained through meditation. I was training there were little things that were red flags. Number one, the school that I started in, it was a quote Christian martial arts. I have no doubt that the founder of that school loved the Lord, but he was deceived as to what he was doing, what it did within the students. Number one, we didn't have to take our shoes off, and we didn't have to bow, and that was a plus, because God says don't bow. Do not bow. And I didn't realize until I came out of it that the reason that the bowing was so important to those high-level masters and grandmasters, like a Shihan or a sensei, whatever, or a Soki, a founder of a style, the reason the bowing was important to them was because the spirit that was influencing them, the spirit that was in those men after sixth dawn, that was the spirit that wanted to be bowed to. Because those fallen angels, when they could get a Christian to bow before someone that they were inside of or controlling, they would mock God. They would say, "This is your child. He's bowing to us." The Bible says in Romans 6:16, it says, "Don't you know that to who we yield ourselves as a servant to obey, that's whose servants, that's whose slaves we are." And Jesus actually said that. He said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, or Master, Master, but yet you won't do the things that I'm asking you?" So when I look at that and the martial arts tells me I need to do this, but Jesus tells me not to do it, I'm making a choice. Who am I obeying? And this wasn't something that happened for me because somebody came to church and did a one-hour presentation. So I encourage you, when I give you that website, go through and read it. Just read it. Do you know what? All of that is gone.
I realize it, but if you were back in the corner, some of that would come out.
No, it would not. No, because that spirit that would cause that was thrown out almost 7 years ago.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Some of us still rely on some things we learned way back when, if we're back in the corner, and some messes. But I thought that here again, I thank the Lord for this.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'll share something with you. I had a gentleman, my mom's husband, God-fearing man, elder in the church. He asked me a number of years ago. He asked me a question. He came up to our house, and he's never done any martial arts, but he asked me that question. He said, "Eric," he said, "tonight," he said, "I know what you've done. I know some of the stuff that, you know, I had done and the fighting, and we did full contact. I mean, bare knuckle." And he said, "If somebody broke into your house tonight," he said, "they were going to hurt your wife and children," he said, "you'd use what you'd learned, wouldn't you?" And while he was asking me this, I was praying. I mean, because I knew. I was like, "Lord, I need your word." Because, you know, I can give you my opinion, but my opinion doesn't mean anything. I said, "I need your word." And I looked at him and I said, "No." I said, "If somebody broke into my house, I'm not going to use the martial arts." And he said, "Why?" And I turned in my Bible, and I knew he believed God. I knew he loves the Lord. I told him, I said, "Turn with me to Psalms chapter 34. I'm going to read this to you, two verses. Psalms 34, verse 7 and 8. The angel of the Lord, the word Lord there is Jehovah or Yahweh. It means the Most High. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good, for blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Now, when I read that verse, I had to make a decision. And I asked my father-in-law, I said, or my mom's husband, I said, "Wayne, I want to ask you a question." I said, "I know you love the Lord." I said, "Do you believe that the Bible is His word?" And I knew the answer. He said, "Of course." I said, "Do you believe that promise?" And he looked at me. And I said, "That's the question each one of us is facing. Do I literally believe God's word? He says the angel of the Lord encamps all around me." Now, before I got out of the martial arts, before the Lord, it wasn't just that I quit practicing it. There had to be a deliverance. I mean, there were things that were inside of me that I had no idea that were there. I thought, this is just my personality. This is who I am. The Lord asked me that. Eric, do you believe me? And I realized the night that the Lord showed that to me, if I don't believe this word, then I need to just throw the whole Bible away and go live in the world and have a good time. Eat, drink, be merry. Tomorrow I may die. Because if I can't believe that He literally means what He's promised me, then I'm wasting my time. Then that means I've only got 70, maybe 80, 90 years of life. Why waste my time playing games if He doesn't mean it? And also, I read testimonies from other men. One man, a Chinese man that had been in Kung Fu. Another man that was a fifth degree in Shotokan karate. His name is Vito Rallo. He's in our film. And they told stories where they had been backed into a corner. And one man, the Chinese man, he said he was actually on the streets in China. And they were, him and two other men, I think elders, they were doing evangelism. And he said, we were there and we were in a downtown area, this rough part. And he said, we pulled up to a stop sign and all of a sudden these thugs came running up to the car. And he said, we had the windows down because there's no air conditioner. And he said, this one guy stuck a gun right to the side of my head through the window, open window. So this man's got a pistol right against the side of his head. And he said, the other two elders knew about his background in the martial arts. And they afterwards said, we were waiting because we knew what you could do to these guys. And gun or no gun. And he said, in that moment, it was like all this stuff flashed through his mind. All these memories of what he had been taught to do and how to do it. And he said, then he heard the voice of the Lord, trust me. And he said, that man had that gun to his head. And he said, he turned into the gun. He said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, get off of me. And he said, the man was literally picked up and thrown backwards almost 8 or 10 feet. And he said, the man got up to his feet and he said his face was like white. He was terrified because an angel had literally picked him up and thrown him. He knew nobody else had touched him. And he took off running. A little while later, the police caught him. And the man told what happened. He said, I literally felt like I was just picked up and thrown. And when I look at that, the way that I see what the Lord has told us, He gives us a promise. You may have to look this one up. Do you remember when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and the disciples were there with Him and then the soldiers were coming to get Him? And Jesus woke them up and He said, you know, they're coming. You know, get ready. And it was funny because before, when Christ had sent those disciples out, He told them something. He said, I want you to go into every village and city, go two by two, and I want you to proclaim the glad tidings. And He told them, He said, don't take a staff with you. Don't take any extra food. Don't take any extra clothes. He said, because the workman is worthy of his hire. And the disciples went out and they came back and they told the Lord, you know, they were so excited. They said, even the devils are subject unto us in Thy name. And Christ asked them, He said, I beheld Satan fall like lightning. In other words, He was saying, why are you surprised? I'm the one that threw him out of heaven. Why are you surprised he has to obey down here? Well, now when Jesus is getting ready to go into this trial, He tells the disciples before this mob shows up, He tells them, He says, when I sent you out before, did you all lack anything? You know what the disciples said? No, sir, we didn't lack anything. There was nothing we needed that wasn't provided. He said, yet I'm telling you now, he that does not have a sword, sell your garment and buy one. And you read that and you go, the Lord told them, don't take any extras. And now He's telling them, go sell your garment and buy a sword. Why is this apparent contradiction? He was trying to teach them faith. And He knew right now they still hadn't learned what He wanted to teach them. They still weren't depending upon Him to provide and to protect them. So He told them something. He said, he that doesn't have a sword, go buy one. Now I had a man that called me, and he had questions about this. He's a Christian. And I told him something. He said, you know, well, Jesus, you know, he taught his disciples how to take care of himself. He even told them to get a sword. I said, okay. I said, let's pretend that Jesus was a martial arts instructor for a minute. There's 12 disciples, 11, because Judas has left now. So there's 11 disciples plus Jesus. Peter jumped up when Jesus said, you know, if you don't have a sword, sell your garment and go buy one. Peter jumped up and he said, Lord, here's two swords. You know what Jesus' answer was? He said, that's enough. He said, it is enough. If Jesus wanted them to defend themselves, if he wanted them to use force of arms, there's Jesus plus 11. That's 12 men, two swords. Somebody's not going to make it home that night. As a martial arts instructor, that's stupid. That's not even smart. Go get 12 swords, one for each of us. Or if I'm the Son of God, which we know he is, get 11 swords. That way at least I'll die and you guys can survive. But they said, we've got two among the 11 of us. And Jesus said, that's enough. And then the mob comes, and you remember what happened? I love Peter. Peter's a lot like how I am. Peter's the first one. First one. He draws that sword, hacks off. He was aiming for that guy's head. It's the grace of God that he didn't take his head clean off. He slices off his ear. What did Jesus do? And you know, Jesus said something. And I praise the Lord that he helped me. And this was a struggle. You know, like I said, this wasn't something over a weekend. It took me almost 8 months after I saw the dangers of the spiritual side just to see the other side. Jesus said, he that lives by the sword shall die by the sword. And I used to look at that and I was like, what is that talking about? What Jesus was actually telling us was, is if you're surviving by the might, by the sword of man, by the power of man, that's going to be how you die. But he doesn't want us to survive by the sword of man. He wants us to survive by his sword, which is the word of the living God. So he told them, if you're going to survive, if that's how you want to protect yourself, I don't think God's going to kick somebody out of heaven because they owned a gun and they were holding on to that for the time of trouble. However, I can tell you this, I want to walk on the higher path. I want to be one like that Chinese man that said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, get off me. I want to be like that woman that was in that car when that rapist abducted her. And you know what she did? She spoke to him of the love of Christ. And he went back to her house and she gave him Bible studies all night long and he turned himself in and gave his life to the Lord. True story. And I look and I say, that's what God wants for us. He wants us to believe in miracles. He wants us to know his power. He wants that. So when I encourage you, each of you, I mean, we've narrowed down to a smaller group. I want to share with you, come and get a card, look at the website. It gives a lot of details. There's a lot of details about the symbols that are used, what they really mean, about what the names of the masters. I'll give you an example. In the Chinese, the training place is called Dao Cheng or Dao Quan. In the Japanese or Okinawan, it's called Dojo. The word literally means the place of enlightenment. That's what the word means in their language. So you think, okay, so who are we being enlightened by? I'll give you another example. When Jesus said, if somebody comes up and they smack you on one side of the face, turn the other cheek. I have a lot of martial artists that battle with that because not that they're intentionally doing something wrong, but you have to make a decision. Does he literally mean that? I'll give you another example. In Matthew, this was one that really hit home with me because the first instructor that I was under, he had been in it for probably 40, 45 years. He was a grandmaster. He was never really, he never pushed some of the Eastern traditions because he also was, you know, professed Christian. So I praise the Lord for that. But the other man that I trained in the Aikido, in the Filipino system, and the other Shaolin Kung Fu master under him, you had to live by protocol. You had to address them under certain names when you were in public. You had to, you know, call him Sifu or Si Joe, which is a founder. When you read in Matthew chapter 23, Jesus tells us something. He says, talking about the Pharisees, he said, all their works they do so they can be seen by men. They make broad their phylacteries. That's the borders, like on the garment. And I remember, like in the Matthew 23, verse 5, I remember in the martial arts, the higher level rank you got, like if it was a green belt or a brown belt, it was just a standard. But normally a black belt, your belt got thicker. And the higher level you got, it became thicker. Thicker, wider, there was more elaborate, your uniform changed. But that's what he's saying these religious leaders did. And we see the same thing in the Roman church. We're seeing it in a lot of other churches now, these vestures that they want to put on. I want to be called pastor. I want to be called head elder. You think, we are all brothers and sisters. You know, if they want to call you that, that's fine. But you don't need to elicit that because you know who you are in Christ. He says they love the uppermost rooms at feast and the chief seats in the synagogues. Same thing in the martial arts. They talk about, like, especially in the Chinese, they talk about these masters being humble. It's a false humility. They love to be bragged on for their humility. He says, and they love greetings in the markets, verse 7. And they love to be called rabbi, rabbi. We see that in the Jewish, you know, traditional or Orthodox Judaism. He says, but be not called rabbi. For one is your master, even Christ, and ye are all brethren. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. The word sijo, or the word sifu in Chinese, or the word sensei in Japanese, is master. It's a master instructor. It's somebody who has promoted someone to the level of black belt. So they're teaching black belts now, not just students. Jesus said, don't call men that. So when we do that, you place yourself under someone else's authority. You place yourself under their influence, which we had to do if you wanted to make rank. If you wanted to progress, you had to. If there was any disrespect, or if you were careless with the amount of respect you showed, you could forget about making rank, especially after black belt. There was no moving up, as this brother knows. It was very strict. But when we do that, when we place ourselves under someone else's authority like that, the spirit that is in the master wants to be passed to the students, to the disciples. Now, I'll give you an example. A man that is a master or a grandmaster, he has, to get that rank, he has a demon that is in his life. There's no way to achieve that rank otherwise. There's no way. And that doesn't mean that you're, like I said, throwing up, you know, green and all this fanaticism. It means there's a spirit that's in you, just like there was, Ellen White said, it was a demon of selfishness that possessed Judas. She said that literally, it was a demon. He walked right there, did all the miracles with Christ, went out with the disciples, but yet she said Jesus kept him the closest to him because he was trying to win him, but Judas would not yield. It was a demon of selfishness that possessed him. So when I'm talking about demons, I'm not talking about, you know, just crazy fanatical stuff. It could be something like that. It could be selfishness, it could be bitterness, it could be, you know, hate, it could be unfaithfulness, it could be lying. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So those, you know, when we yield, those spirits, they know, like with a master, let's say a grandmaster, as he gets older, the abilities that they have spiritually excel. The older they get, and they can say it's experience, but when you're moving people without touching them from 15 or 25 feet away, or when you're breaking solid concrete blocks, boards is one thing. Yes, there's some physical, and I understand that. But when you're breaking things that the human body, the human hand can't, it physically cannot endure the punishment that we did to it. And you pay for it. You know, down the years, it comes back to haunt you. Our bodies weren't designed for that. But that spirit knows this flesh and blood is only going to last so long. That demon knows that. So what they do in the masters and grandmasters is they start looking for who's the number one student? Who's the one that I can be passed on to? That this knowledge and this ability can be passed to? And normally a master will start bringing that student closer to him. And that's when you become a disciple. It's when that master starts taking personal time alone with you and coaxing you, and he's grooming you to take his position, to be the heir of his art. So when that happens, that's what's happening. That demon, that fallen angel, he's looking for, who am I going to be passed to when this guy can't do it anymore? And that spirit gets passed. And then when we look in the Bible, like Jesus said, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. That's how the demons also project spirit. It's through words. It's through music. It's through television. It's through movies. It's through the literature that we're reading. Like I tell my daughter, she's in college now. And I mean, it's a secular college. Even if it was a Seventh-day Adventist Christian college, there's reading there that I think, you know, that's not, I wouldn't want to waste my time on it. But I tell her, I say, you got to remember something. When you're reading that, whatever spirit inspired the person to write what they're writing is trying to reach you through those words that they wrote. The same thing happens when an instructor. You've got an instructor in a Taekwondo or a karate studio or a kung fu studio. Well, he is passing on that spirit to all those students that is passed to him from his instructor. And his instructor gets that blessing or that spirit impartation from the one above him. And all of them, they bow to the abbot of the Shaolin Temple. There's no instructor in the world that will refuse to bow to the abbot of the Shaolin Temple. None of them. And we actually show a photograph of him on the throne at the Shaolin Temple, and there's hundreds of these little idols all behind him. Those are all the demons that give him his abilities. So when they bow to him, that spirit is passed down. That's why lineage is so important in the martial arts. In martial arts, they want to know, you know, who was your, did you just make this up? Or did you just a good street fighter? They want that lineage. How can I trace your lineage back to, you know, the founder of this art? And then when you go back to the founders of the art, no matter what the discipline, find out where their inspiration came from. That's what shocked me. When you actually read in their own words how they were inspired to develop their arts. So Jesus tells us, he says, call no man master. Call no man sensei or sifu. Because when we do that, we're yielding ourselves. And as we open up that door, I guess probably the biggest thing that hit me was the whole gospel is focused on one thing. That's the restoring in man the image of our Creator, His character and His image. And we see Jesus, we see His character in the gospels. It's all through the Bible, but specifically in the gospels. It's very clear to us. This is the character of our Father in heaven, and this is the character of our Savior. So anything that I do that is changing my character into an image different than Jesus Christ, then it's not of God. If you look at Jesus, was he humble? Was he meek? Was he forgiving? Was he tolerant? Was he merciful? In the martial arts, does it teach us to be humble? And I'll give you an example. Merciful, I used to joke about that. I mean, all of us guys would say, yeah, we showed him mercy. I mean, we threw him on the ground and we took his arm out of joint instead of breaking his neck. Is that mercy or is that pride? I mean, it's the truth. And when I looked at the children that would come in, you'd watch them the first day that they came, the first week that they came, and after a year of training, you'd watch their character change. We'd watch the young people where they came in, and they came in because they were told they were going to be taught self-confidence and self-esteem and self-defense. Well, the first word in all of those is self, which is the one thing that we're told in the Bible is our greatest enemy. That's the one thing we need to kill is self. Self needs to die. But yet, and it's not just martial arts. I mean, there's lots of things out there that do that. They're building self. So if I'm building that which needs to be destroyed, I'm fighting against my Savior. And like I said, I'm doing this as a really rough overview. because there's a lot of it that in the film that you'll see and on the website. I mean, you can go through there and we go into great detail. And we have quotes from the men in all these different arts, what these masters said the art was about, what the purpose for the art was, and then right to the side of it we put, this is what the Bible says. So do we have any other questions?
Did any of the past teachers communicate with you for whatever reason? Have you seen any?
Yes, sir. I'll tell you a story. The last man that I trained under, the one that was a 10th degree in two systems, I was a 5th degree or 5th dawn. To make that next step was a 6th degree. That's when you're called a master. And you couldn't get that unless, it's not like doing just a test. It was like when we did first or second. You had requirements. You meet these requirements, you pass this test, you've got it. Sixth dawn was not that way. It was something that the master over you just had to know. He had to know you're ready. And I understand now the reason he had to know was because the spirit that empowered him had to tell him, this guy's ready. And I know now the reason that he never promoted me to sixth dawn was because he kept trying to get me to do programs and to teach classes on the Sabbath. Even though I was, you know, living in adultery, even though I was away from my wife and children, I still wouldn't work on Sabbath. I know that sounds dumb. It's like I was watching rated R movies and doing every other kind of evil, but I wouldn't work on Sabbath. And that was why he wouldn't promote me, because he kept asking me, Eric, why don't you do this program? I can get you a bunch of students here. You can make big money, you know. And I was just like, I couldn't. I don't know why. Those seeds that had been planted in me when I was a child, the Lord just, he kept them there. Amen. And
it brings to mind Ellen White when she said that if the world would keep the Sabbath, there would be no evolution.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
That's so, very helpful.
So this man, he didn't want to promote me to that six. He wanted to, but it was like I wouldn't give in on that one part. He wouldn't tell me that's what it was, but I knew. I mean, you know. And I was there at the school one night, and the Lord, he showed me what it was I was doing. I was teaching an internal art called Bagua. It's sort of like Tai Chi, which is all about energy. It's about channeling this power, this internal strength that's inside of you. And some people use it for healing, quote unquote. Some people use it for breaking boards. Other people will let, you know, boards be hit on them. I mean, the training that we would do, we would have somebody swing like a 2x4 at us, or a 1-inch or 2-inch thick oak board, and you'd raise your arm up and it hit it, no bruise and shatter. I mean, that's impossible. No bruise. You know, when we first started, yeah, there was bruises. But after a couple of years, I'd stick my arm out, they'd throw it, it'd break, no big deal. Didn't even hurt. Of course, later on you wind up feeling it. But the demons would stop you from feeling that pain. They would stop the physical actions, just like they do when people walk on coals of fire. That's demonic. That's not, you can't find that anywhere, you know. Unless the Holy Spirit does it, it's an evil spirit that's doing it. So I got to the point where I knew that this internal side of the martial arts was bad. So what I did was I said, I'm going to separate it. I'm going to throw the spiritual side out. I'll cut myself off from the spiritual side. I'm just going to do the physical side. But I didn't know how to tell this grandmaster that, because after fifth degree, if you're not going to do internal training or spiritual training, you're wasting your time. It was just, I mean, it was meaningless. So I was like, I can't tell him that I'm not doing chi training anymore, because then I won't make that rank. So he called me, wanted to do a seminar at my school. And usually a couple times a year he would come up. A grandmaster would do that. All your students would come. Other students from other schools would come. It was a big deal. And he called and he was like, you know, what would you think about us doing a seminar? I said, that's a good idea. And he said, okay, I'll be up on such and such a date. You get everything set up. So I set everything up, set out all the invitations. And he showed up that morning before anybody else. And he and I were talking. And he said, what do you want us to do this on today? What do you need in the school right now? And I was like, okay, normally he's going to come up and he wants to do something on chi. And like I said, with what I was doing, there was a lot of spiritual influence. I mean, like, I would lay on the ground and let two men grab my arm and try to pull me. And I mean, I could lay flat on my back and two men, I mean, you and another man, any man in here, could pull and you couldn't move me off that spot on the floor. That's impossible. I mean, that's impossible. You can't hold on to the floor while you're laying on your back and somebody's pulling on your arm. But we were taught how to do that, supposedly, through this energy. Well, he would come up and he could move me from where David and I are standing. From here to David, he could take his hand and he could push me, and I could not stop him from pushing me without touching me. Like, you see that stuff in the movies, like in Star Wars, all that stuff we let our children watch. It's real. It's real. It's not jokes. He'd take his hand and he'd go like that, and I could feel this pressure, and it would shove me. And I would do everything I could to stop. All the chi training and everything, no avail. I couldn't stop him. So I knew that's what he always wanted to do when he came up for a seminar. He would do some type of training to impress the students, because that also helped me, because they knew that whatever he was showing them, I had already learned, so they would come to the school and everybody would be, you know, looking at the instructor. Well, he asked me, he said, what do you want to teach today? And I thought, I've got to have something physical where he can't do any demonstrations of this energy. I've got to have something just physical. So I told him, I said, let's do ground fighting. Everybody's all excited about the UFC, you know, right now. Let's do ground fighting, because he can't do anything with that. Well, so we spent 4 hours nonstop. I mean, just one drill after another, training all these people. And they were exhausted. I mean, they were exhausted at the end of those 4 hours. And then he comes over at the end of the 4 hours when everybody's exhausted, their mental guard is down. And he says, that last technique that I showed you, he said, let me show you how to really do that. And he was standing probably 6 feet away from me, 5 or 6 feet away from me. He said, you do it like this. And he held his hand up. And normally he'd hold his hand up, and if he started, quote, projecting this energy, I could feel it. I mean, if he'd held his hand up, you could feel, it felt like electricity. It was like a tingling and a pressure. He held his hand up. And for the first time in 9 years, I didn't feel anything. I mean, I didn't feel anything. What he didn't know was, is that morning before he came, there was a couple of other students that were Christians. And they knew what I was going through, how I was trying to separate the spiritual from the physical. I asked them to pray. I said, let's pray. I said, I don't know what's going on. I said, I'm not sure what's right and what's wrong in this situation. I said, let's just pray and let's ask the Lord Jesus Christ to stop any power from having authority or ability here if it's not of him. So we prayed together. Well, this man comes up and he does this projection, which normally I would have felt in a second. I didn't feel anything. And he just looked at me because he was waiting to see me move like I normally did. And he said, you feel that? I said, no, sir. I was still being respectful because I didn't want to lose rank or my possibility of that. So he got his hand closer. And then he got it closer. And then he got it closer. And then he put his hand right on my shoulder. I still didn't feel anything. And he put his head down, and he turned around, and he walked to the back of my school, shaking his head. He couldn't understand why something that always worked no longer worked. And
later on, he was actually moving his girlfriend up into the town where I lived. I knew what that meant, because he shared a place with her. So if he's moving her up here, that means he's planning on being at my school a whole lot more. And normally in martial arts, that'd be a good thing if the grandmaster is wanting to come stay at your school.
Yeah.
And when I found out he was moving her up there, I told my wife, I said, I'm the one to tell him. I mean, I can't keep hiding from him that I'm not training in chi anymore. And I called him. I told him, I want to come over and help you, because I know you got to move her and unload and all that. Well, the day, I think it was the day or the day before he showed up, the Lord told me, he said, Eric, I've called him. He was raised as a Christian. I mean, the Lord told me this. I never talked to him about his family before. The Lord just told me, he said, you need to tell him that I love him. And I thought, oh, man, I was terrified. you know. I thought just telling him I was, you know, not going to be doing the other stuff in martial arts was bad. Now the Lord's telling me to go tell him that I love him. And so I went over there and I helped him move, and we got done moving. He said, "Eric," he said, "I want to show you something." And this man's probably 60, 61. I was probably 35. And I mean, he was like a tank. I mean, he was a tank. I'd never met anybody that was like this guy, what he could do in martial arts. He said, "I want to show you something." So he came over and he's trying to show me this thing on the ground, like a ground technique, and he was trying to project this energy. And it's like, I went through the motions, and then I got up off the ground. I said, "Dang," I said, "I appreciate you showing me." I said, and I was praying the whole time. I was like, "Lord, I need your help." I said, "Dang," I said, "I need to tell you something." I said, "The reason that it doesn't work on me anymore," I said, "it's because of the Lord Jesus Christ." And I said, "You were raised as a Christian, weren't you?" He said, "Yeah, my mom and dad were Christians." I said, "Well, the Lord told me this week that he loves you and he has a calling on your life." I said, and Dana, I said, "That's not normal." I said, "I don't normally have God tell me stuff." I said, "But he told me. And he told me specifically that he's called." And Dane just looked at me, and I told him, I said, "I'm done. I'm not doing martial arts anymore." And I hugged him, and then I guess it was, I don't know, a month, maybe a month and a half later, I started sending him emails. And I said, actually, I mailed him some packages too with some articles from my wife about God's love. Not about what he was doing wrong, but just about God's love. And yeah, he read them. And he knew, I knew he read them because he wrote back about what was in them.
And then I thought, you know, I bet he doesn't even have a Bible. So my wife and I went out and we bought him a nice Bible, a leather, genuine leather Bible, and we got his name engraved on it. And I mailed that to him. That was the last I heard from him. He sent me an email and he said, "I got your gift." He said, "Eric," he said, "that means more to me." He said, "Nobody's ever done something like that for me." Hadn't heard from him since then. And that was 2008. So if you guys would, lift him in prayer. Because that's my purpose. My goal is not, I don't want to see anybody lost. Yes, sir.
I was watching this program the other night on TV that was showing Benny Hinn slaying people in the spirit.
Yes, sir.
But then he did something I'd never seen before. He was slaying the whole audience.
Yes, sir.
And they were falling down like dominoes.
Yes, sir.
Is that demon possession or both or what?
It's the same. It is the same power that's doing that. And in this film, we actually show clips of what the Hindu people call Kundalini. It's something in yoga. We show the Hindu people what it looks like when this Kundalini spirit manifests. And then we show clips from like Benny Hinn and some of the other charismatic stuff that's going on. It's identical. I mean, we show them side by side. It's the identical thing. And there's other Christians out there, not Adventists, that are exposing this. They're saying, this is not of God. This is a counterfeit. Satan is doing everything he can to counterfeit the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Even within our church, you've got many Adventists that don't believe in miracles anymore. I mean, they'll say, we've got the health message. That's the miracle of healing. I'm like, praise the Lord, we've got the health message. But that's not the end of it. You read Ellen White's writings, and she says under the latter rain, she said, miracles are going to be wrought. The sick will be healed. Yes, we need to eat healthy and preserve our bodies as the temple of the living God. But there's a difference between that and you putting your hands on somebody and saying, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's not something, we don't need fanaticism. You know, I mean, you know, there's a lot of people out there that they'll run with something and it turns into fanaticism. That's not what God wants. But at the same time, we don't want to lessen or to deny the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So that we're seeing that right now. It's like Satan, he knew the health message was coming. He saw what the Lord gave to us through, you know, the early Advent movement. And what has he got out there right now? Do you know what? Instead of the Adventists giving the health message, he's got the New Agers giving the health message. Go to almost any health food store, all the magazines, a lot of the products have got Hindu and New Age words, and it's everywhere. So he's got, you know, Reiki. He's got, you know, kinesiology. He's got iridology. He's got muscle testing, you know, where they'll check and see if an herb works for you. So they'll get you to hold your arm up and they'll push down on it while you're holding it over your thymus. And if that works good for you, you won't be able to move your arm. You'll be strong. But if that herb's not for your body, then your arm will go down. That's a lie. There's no way in the world that your thymus can read through a bottle what's in this. It's ridiculous. It's actually part of Qigong, which we did in Shaolin Kung Fu. Yes, ma'am.
And she did that experiment where you hold your arm out.
Yes, ma'am.
You could not put it down. I mean, I'm serious. It was just against your body to do that. So you knew there was, you had a little help on that arm.
Yeah.
And when she removed it, your arm would just fall like a pancake.
Yeah. That's not of God. That actually only works because of the power of those angels, those fallen angels. My wife, she went one time. It was during the time that her and I were separated. A friend of hers that went to martial arts practice with me, she was a lady that was a brown belt. She asked her, said, why don't we go see this man? Because she knew my wife was struggling emotionally. I mean, when you go through a divorce and separation. She said, why don't we go see this man? He's a Qigong healer, which is like a form of using energy to heal. She said, let's go see him. I think he could help you. So my wife and her went, and the other lady's a strong Christian, but they just didn't know. And he got there, and he was doing this work on her, you know, feeling of her body, trying to, without touching her, running his hands over to see where there's, quote, blockage of the energy. And he was trying to work to get that, quote, bad energy out that was causing her all this stress. It's not bad energy. It's just called, my husband left me. You know, it hurts. And he stopped and he said, I can't do anything. He said, you won't let me in. Something won't let me in. And Sarah just looked at him. She said, what do you mean? He said, there's this bright light and I can't get in to work on you, to get rid of whatever's causing this hurt. And my wife said, she looked over at her friend Linda and they got up and they left. And Linda said, I'll never do that again. My wife was like, we prayed before we went in there that the Lord wouldn't allow anything. And that man could see there's something that won't let me in. And so the Lord is, right now there's a reason why the devil is counterfeiting. There's a reason why he wants our children to depend on self rather than to depend on him. And that doesn't make us weak. I appreciate what this man said. I'm not a weak Christian at all. Sometimes I might be a little bit too strong. Willed. I don't believe in a weak Christian. I don't believe Paul or Peter or John or Jesus, any of them were weak men. Okay? But we want to be men that are dependent on God. And I have found, especially over the last few years, the more dependent I am on Him, the more power and the more glory He receives and He gives. Yes, ma'am. He does it in the name of Jesus. But Paul even talks about that. Paul says, if someone comes and they preach another Jesus whom I have not preached, it's not the same Jesus of the Bible. I'll give you an example. That last grandmaster that I trained under, his girlfriend, she was probably in her 50s. Her and one of her best friends were heavily, heavily into the New Age. Did a lot of stuff with Edgar Cayce and heavily New Age, also in the martial arts. They came up and they met my wife one day, and my wife invited them to go to church because she thought, I want to see if I can get these ladies to go to church. And so she took them to church, and they told her, they said, oh, we believe in Jesus. They had no problem with Jesus. He was just one of many ascended masters. The Hindu people, that's one of the struggles that our missionaries have with the Hindu people. When they go to India, they'll accept Jesus, and they'll put a little statue of him right alongside all the other statues. We've got a God that gives me ability with this, and I've got a God for health, and I've got a God for financial prosperity, and I've got a God for reproduction in my family. Oh, this is Jesus. This will be a God that forgives me of my sins. And they don't understand. There's one. He's the only one. So that's, you know, when Benny Hinn, I'm not judging him, but what he's doing is not of God. When you see him throwing people down, I can show you film clips of the yoga people doing it, film clips of the martial arts masters doing it. God never, not one time in the entire scripture, did he throw somebody down.
Amen.
The only time that anyone ever fell down was, remember when Christ said, they asked if he was Jesus of Nazareth, he said, I am, and they fell backwards as dead men. He never did that when he was healing somebody, ever, not one time. He always picked man up. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And that word will not fail you. It will not fail you.
It's amazing. I was watching. I say this is the devil, but you can't say it because you think that is and you don't know. This guy is walking on water. This guy was walking right from the river, and he started walking right from the center of the river.
Mm-hmm.
And I was trying to know that you're talking about all these things.
When one of the drills that they did at the Shaolin Temple, I mean, they've done it for hundreds of years, okay? And we were trained how to do this, you know, years ago. When I first became a green belt, we got to go to this special class where they would teach things that they wouldn't teach to the white belts. They brought out something called rice paper. And it's this very thin oriental paper. It's very thin. Well, we had to walk on that without tearing it or without making a sound. And sometimes if we didn't have rice paper, they'd bring out plastic. And you take out a sheet of plastic and walk on it without being able to hear. I mean, it's impossible just about. So we would practice and practice and practice and train to be able to do this. And then after you got to a point where you could walk on that for, you know, 15, 20 feet without being able to hear any sound, then he would take you to the next step and we'd start working on how to change our weight. Literally to be able to stand on a scale or I'll give you an example. The first grandmaster I trained under, he showed it to me when I was probably a brown belt. In front of the whole class, he wanted to demonstrate to them how it could be done. He said, Eric, he said, you lie down on your back. So I did. He said, I'm going to step up on your chest, and then I'm going to step off. He said, I want you to tell me how much weight you felt. So I laid on my back. I didn't know what to expect. He weighed about 185 pounds. He came over. He stepped up onto my chest, both feet, and then he stepped off. Do you know how much weight I felt? No more than 10 pounds. It was nothing. It was nothing. And I was in awe. So I started training that. And then I started training, you know, doing the reverse of it. When I say training it, you have to yield the mind. It's like being hypnotized. The only way somebody can be hypnotized is if they surrender the mind. So to be hypnotized, you have to have a strong authority figure, somebody that you believe in, and you have to have the words, the power of suggestion, and then you have to grasp it. So we would train, you read these books that are giving you the words, it's from an authority figure, you hear a master or a grandmaster, he's an authority figure, and he's telling you what to expect, this is what you're going to feel, this is what it's going to do, and you believe it. And as you yield, those spirits come in, and they work that quote-unquote magic in your life. And then after a while, after you got to, you know, past black belt, on into, you know, third, fourth, fifth dawn, then he would start taking you out in the snow. And you'd try to walk across snow without leaving footprints. Or he'd start working on body temperature. That was like one of the last things we had to do, to be able to change our body temperature. And it started with change the whole body. We'd be working out. We didn't have an air conditioner in our dojo. It was old-fashioned. You'd be working out in there. It'd be 96 degrees, 98 degrees. And he'd tell you, make your body get cold. And so you train and train and train and practice and meditate and think. And while you're exercising, it got to the point where we could bring our body temperature down to where it was, you know, 69, 70, 72 degrees. And then he'd stick you in the cold, it'd be 30 or 40 degrees, and he'd say, bring your body temperature up. So we'd make it to where, I mean, you're sweating and it's freezing cold outside. You're just standing there meditating. And then it got to the point where he'd say, okay, make this whole arm hot, and he'd pick one finger, make that one finger cold. It's self-hypnosis. It's demonic. It does not, the human body was never designed to do that. And Ellen White even talks about that. You can read if you look up what she says about it. All of these things that we're seeing today, she was shown before. She was shown. All of the New Age mysticism that we're seeing in this country was coming into the country in the 1800s. There was a woman named Madame Blavatsky. You guys may be familiar with her. She was one of the main proponents of the Theosophical Society. All of them were bringing this in. Evolution, Darwin, all of that was coming in. All at the same time, the devil was attacking. When 1844, 1888, when that message for the Advent people was coming, he was bringing in all these counterfeits at the exact same time. But all of that, the moment that you surrender to the Lord, you say, I renounce it. I take back every inch of ground that I've yielded to the enemy. I don't want any gifts of the enemy. I don't want any power from the enemy. Anything. I renounce it. It's gone. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Martial arts. And my experience was in the Dynamic Discussion Club. In 1981, I was in this competition in France that my father was working with. So we started buying books on yoga. It happened that in Romania, where I am from, in 81, an entire year, I and my brother went center in Bucharest and took yoga classes in Hatha Yoga.
Yes, ma'am.
And of course from there I have the books about Kundalini and so on. So what I was feeling every time, or in the meantime, leading those classes, was I was lighter. I was, of course, happier. I was readier to encounter the bad aspects or whatever is happening in life, you know?
Yes, ma'am.
And, well, about the spiritual, the Kundalini and meditations and so on, I just knew that it's not coming from me. I mean, it's something outward, you know? And, of course, it was no way to follow that. We were still under the communists. And that was my only experience. And I just wanted you to point again, the physical
I'll give you an example, and that's a good question, a very good question. When Satan speaks a lie or brings a deception, what makes the deception work? It has to be truth and error combined. A lie by itself, nobody will buy it. I mean, it's unbelievable. So what Satan does is he mixes the two. Like if you look at a yin and yang, you know, what we call yin and yang here in the South. But the yin and yang, it's the blending of light and darkness, of good and evil. To all of the Asian cultures, that symbol is God. They call that the Tao. And they say that Tao, that yin and yang, is a combination of positive and negative energy. Energy. It's another word for spirit. Okay? They say that that is the ultimate God, is this combining of light and darkness. The scripture tells us in 1 John, God is light and in him is no darkness at all. None.
Amen.
And that right there, that by itself really threw me. So when we look at how Satan is blending the physical with the spiritual, and people say, well, I can just throw the spiritual out. I did everything I possibly could because I planned on being 120 and still teaching martial arts. And I mean, I had a studio, I had a school, I had a business, and I mean, I closed all of it down. When we look at how the devil combines those two and blends them together, I'll give you an example. One of the reasons that people, whenever they do yoga, or they'll do Tai-chi. We'll use those two specifically. because both of them are very similar. Yoga and Tai Chi, their main focus is always on breathing. Always. Deep breathing. I can go to Ellen White's writings, and she tells us that we should breathe from our abdomen. And now you've got people coming into the church now that are saying, see, Ellen White was a mystic. No, she wasn't a mystic. She was the Lord's messenger. She said breathe low because you want to use the diaphragm. Okay, the devil took that and he said, I'm going to blend some other things with that. Because if they can see on the surface, breathe deep, then I can also get them to take this other thing to swallow it. Like a Trojan horse. You're taking what you see, but you don't realize what's on the inside. So how do you breathe deep without doing yoga? That's easy. Go for a walk. Jump on a trampoline. Go for a jog. Go play tennis. Go play basketball. Go play soccer. All of those things don't have occult spirits behind them. It's just exercise. So what you do is you say, okay, what about the stretching, the other part? That's the other part of Tai Chi and yoga that helps you feel better, stretching. It's easy to stretch without doing Tai Chi or yoga. The word Tai Chi means Tai Chi, the grand ultimate energy. Tai, grand or ultimate. Chi, force or energy. In Daniel, it talks about, you know, the Antichrist. It says he'll worship a god of forces, a god whom his fathers knew not. All of these martial artists, when you look at who they bow to Rome. Not because he's a martial artist, not because the Pope is a martial artist, but because it's the same power. It's the same power. And you'll see that in the documentary. When you do the exercise, you want to look and say, is there anything attached to this? Yoga, the very word yoga. And if you get online, there's actually a film done by a lady named Carol Matriciana. It's one of the best films I've ever seen in my life on this aspect. She was actually British, raised in India by her father, who was a diplomat there. And she spent probably the first 18, 20 years of her life heavily involved in the New Age and yoga. And she now is a Christian, and she's going all over the world sharing with people about the dangers of this Eastern mysticism, and specifically yoga. The name of the film is called Yoga Uncoiled. You may be able to watch it for free online. If you can't find it for free online, it's worth the $15 or $20 to buy it. You'll never regret it. That's called Yoga Uncoiled. Uncoiled. And her name is Carol Matriciana. But if you type in Yoga Uncoiled, it'll bring it up on the first search. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
We say he or she, which is say Qigong and stuff like that.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, they, at some hospital, they tested when they were training, you know, he. And you can see, you know, I don't know what you say, you can read your temperature.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows the different light that comes out of your body actually when you train.
Were they using like a Carillion photography?
I don't know.
Because I know that's.
It was on the TV and I thought, oh, that's strange.
Yeah.
That's
Yes, ma'am.
So the health but people say when you do things like that, your health gets better, and your muscles and physically you're getting better. So I don't know if you're not doing that now. The health that you are now and back then compared to, do you have any different feeling that you stop?
Well, you think the easiest way to put this, and I can show you in Scripture, but I can also show you from Ellen White. She said, if I had a choice to be healed by the devil or die and be in the Lord's hands, she said, it's always better to choose death. I have people that come into the health food store, because I work there like 15 hours a week, and people will come in and they're like, yeah, but this works. And I'm like, but that doesn't make it of God. Just because you feel an effect from it. And what the devil has done is he's gotten us to a point where we base reality on how we feel. that made me feel so good. I mean, I can remember people used to come into my school, and it's like we would do a Tai Chi class or a Qigong class, and they would get done. They would be like, wow, I have never felt that way before. And they'd keep coming back because of the way it made them feel. Now, feelings are not a bad thing. God's the one that designed our feelings, but feelings are supposed to follow. They're not supposed to lead. Does that make sense? So just because something works does not mean it's of God. We have to ask ourselves, what's the power behind what makes it work? I'll give you an example. Has anybody ever heard of water witching? Rod and pendulum, water witching. They used to, no offense, but like years ago, like my grandfather's day, it was everywhere. Now you can still find it, but they would have a rod. You'd have one man or a woman in a neighborhood that had a special stick. And if you were looking for a place to drill a well and you couldn't find, you didn't want to waste money because you know how much money that costs if you drill a well and there's no water there. They'd get this man or woman to come over and they'd walk around your property with this stick. And they'd walk and walk and walk until the stick would bend to the ground and find the water. And people say it worked. I'm like, but that doesn't mean it's of God. There's a reason why it's called water witching. And one of the things that really struck me about it was that one of the grand masters that I trained under, he was familiar with it. And he said, it's the same thing. He said, it doesn't matter if it's water. He said, there's people, and I know this, there's people that will call that man in that neighborhood, not the grand master, but one of the men that practices water witching, when they lose their keys. How does that stick know? Is there some chemical in the stick that's attracted to the water? It's a dead stick. It's been cut. Well, now when you tell me that I've lost my keys or I lost my wallet and it's finding that, you explain that to me. It can't. It's not the rod. It's the person that's being channeled through. I'll give you another example. The higher level that I went in the Chinese martial arts, the more you expanded trying to learn more. You know, you don't want to just stay isolated as this one thing. So I really started looking into like the traditional Chinese medicine because I already knew about the health message. I was like, well, I can just add this to the health message. So we started really studying into that, like acupuncture and acupressure and all of these Eastern healing techniques and New Age healing techniques. Well, come to find out, I listened to a sermon. It was actually a message given by an old Adventist, he's dead now, evangelist, and it was on acupuncture and hypnosis. And he had actually done a lot of research. Well, I went and looked at what he had talked about to see if it was true, because I don't want to just buy it. I want to know. I've seen it myself. According to the Chinese masters in traditional Chinese medicine, in their own writings from 100, 200, 300 years ago, they said something that was very startling. They said when someone comes to an acupuncturist where they put the needles in, they said the needles have nothing to do with the person's healing. They said the needles are only used for the doctor to channel his energy through. His energy. So you put the needle there, and then the doctor is supposed to channel this vibrational energy through the needle into the patient's body. Well, the Bible tells us not to put any piercings in our skin. You know, if you have to do something, you have to have blood drawn or whatever, I don't think the Lord's, you know, upset about that. But he's talking about, you're not going to be healed by sticking acupuncture needles in you. There's a lot of people that say they've had great results, but it's demonic. It's not of God. There's no physical, they have a map that they lay out with all the 12 meridians on it. There's 360 main acupuncture points, and then you've got all kinds of extra ones. And they say if you can tap in on these points, first the doctor has to find out where this, quote, energy blockage is. They say that there's this energy that runs through the human body, and somehow you've got a blockage, and that's what's causing you to be sick, whatever your ailment is. So he'll run his hands over your body. He'll do different rituals to find out where that blockage is. Then once he's found that blockage, he'll insert certain needles in a certain sequence at a certain time for a certain length of time that's supposed to open up this blockage of an energy that we can't even identify. It's not electrical energy. It's not chemical energy. It doesn't exist. So when they do that, the masters actually said the needles are not necessary. They said the higher level that you get in the practice of acupuncture, you don't even have to put the needle in. You can just touch with the finger. They said the great masters, the ones that have really progressed, they don't even have to be in the same room. It can be done across the city. They just have to think it, and you feel it. Yes, ma'am.
Does that mean that their energy goes to you? Does that mean there's a transfer of demon to those people?
It means that the spirit that is in them is causing the effect in this person.
But that transfer to that?
Not always, no. It doesn't have to. That depends on the person, on how much they're yielding. Let me catch her real quick.
Yeah.
That, when you rub that little point, there's a nerve, like a physical nerve.
So does that mean like having that little body map and stuff like that?
It depends on what the body map is showing you.
Because, you know, it has like all the different, like sinus 27 for liver or whatever. Are those connected to all of the nerves?
You would have to look. If it says that it sounds like an acupuncture or a meridian diagram with all the points. I'm going to interject just an idea here.
Okay.
That's an area that is very, very, very gray and dangerous. I'll give you an example. If somebody's constipated, there's easy ways to find out what's causing it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's easy ways to fix it. Most of the time, there can be a B vitamin deficiency. You can add prune juice, you can add raw carrot juice, you can add more water. There can be very simple, lay off, just for an example, you can lay off, you know, refined flours. That's physical. You do have nerves, which you can press on, but that's where the devil crosses that line and he starts blending Eastern mysticism with a physical event. That's where I would be very careful. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
They work on feet. But isn't that an okay thing?
No.
It is not.
All of that is based on the meridian therapy out of the Chinese medicine. All of that. Yes, ma'am.
What if I have the map of column to feet as all the centers of the organs in my body and I put the pressure myself, which I am doing because I don't think anybody, any host.
I would be in much prayer.
Okay.
I would be in much prayer. And I can tell you this. If you ask the Lord, if you ask Him and you say, Father, I really want to know if this is of You. You ask Him. And I'm going to say a prayer also. He'll answer you. No, it's okay.
When you heal somebody who loses needles, I'm sure when you said the needles are coming from the reason of channeling the energy, but you said that there is nothing. I mean, it's no energy. How can it be no energy when the black pictures and ultrasounds and those show our organs dead, cancer spreading into our body? And other ultrasounds or that picture is showing bright colors or
There's
what are we if we are not energy? And sorry, I'm stopping. How can we become healers in Jesus' name? I mean, while only Jesus on earth could heal by touching or from the distance, or how can we be good?
Okay, that's a good point. How did Jesus heal? How did Jesus heal? Faith. Faith in what? God's word. Every single time that you find somebody that was set free from a demon, if they were healed, if they were delivered, if they were raised from the dead, faith. Always there was faith. So when we look, and the devil's even counterfeiting that. I mean, you all heard Oprah Winfrey. She's talked about that movie back a few years ago, The Secret, that they were putting together, and the law of attraction, and all of this stuff. They're saying believe, but they're leaving God's word out of that. It's not our belief that does anything. It's God's word that does the miracle. Amen. So when we heal, it's not us healing. It's God's word that's healing. So we've got to take hold of faith. Even Jesus, I'll give you an example. Do you remember when Jesus, remember when he appeared to the disciples in that storm on the boat? And it says when he got into the boat that immediately the boat was at the place it was supposed to be. Do you know that's actually prophesied in the Old Testament? In Isaiah, it said he would do that. Everything that Jesus did because he had his Father's instruction book. Jesus could look back here and say, that's talking about me. That's what I'm supposed to do. Everything in here is about him. That's why it says the Word was made flesh. So when we look to heal somebody, and I'm going to read something to you. I meant to read this earlier, and you have to forgive me. There's, and like I said, we do not at all want to get near fanaticism. And there's a lot of that out there. But we want to look and we want to be led by the Spirit. And when you're led by God's Spirit, He will tell you. It won't be you doing it. And you certainly won't ever charge somebody for doing it. Jesus said, freely we have been given, freely give in return. That's number one. If somebody tells me that they're doing healing and they're charging for it, I know it's not. They may have a good technique for some kind of natural health or herb or something, but it's not God that's doing the healing. Do you understand? He does for free. He always does it for free. In Mark chapter 16, Jesus said something. Verse 15, he said, go ye into all the world and proclaim the glad tidings to every creature. Whenever you see the word preach there in the New Testament, almost every single time in the Greek, it means proclaim. Preaching, people say, we've got a preacher. I'm not a preacher. I can't do that. Proclaim, everybody can proclaim. Amen. Amen. He says, proclaim the glad tidings to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned or condemned. Jesus tells us in John, we were born condemned. This is the condemnation that light has come into the world and men like darkness better than light. He's not mad at us. We're already condemned. If we don't, that's like my brother. My brother said something to me one time, and I'm praying for him. He's getting so much closer to the Lord. I know the Lord's got his hand on him. But he asked me something. This was years ago. He said, well, what kind of God would I want to serve that tells me love me or I'm going to kill you? That's the way the devil was painting this in his mind. Love me, or I'm going to kill you. And I was like, Lord, how do I explain this? And the Lord just, he gave me a picture. I said, Brian, I said, if you and I go scuba diving, and you decide you don't want the regulator in your mouth anymore, that's not me killing you. It's you letting go of the only way you have life. Christ is our life. The moment we let go of him, we're already dead. He says, and these signs shall follow them that believe. They follow. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new languages, new tongues. It says they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. The word take up serpents there in the Greek means they'll loose serpents. It means to get them off of you. It doesn't mean they're going to pick them up. Look up the word loose or take up. It means loose. to deliver from. It says, they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Jesus, in more than four different instances in the Gospels, gave authority to his disciples. He said, I give you power and authority to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out evil spirits. He said, go tell the glad tidings. What glad tidings? That you're free, that you have been healed, that your sins are no longer upon you. That's what he wants us to share. And it's faith in his promise that opens the door. Faith is the key that unlocks the treasures of heaven. How many of you have read that before? Faith unlocks the treasures of heaven. It's not our faith that does the miracle. It's his word that does the miracle. But faith is what connects us with God's word. And sometimes I've struggled and I've been like, God, I know you said it. I want to believe it, but I don't believe it. Help me to believe. Help thou mine unbelief. And you know what God said to me? Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. So if I'm struggling with sin in my life, I don't need to go read Daniel and Revelation. Do you understand? If I'm struggling with my marriage, I don't need to go read about how Joshua tore down the walls of Jericho. I need to go read the promises that fit my circumstance. I need to find promises for what I'm needing. And as you do that, as you read them out loud, your faith will grow. And God's word will be manifest in your life because he promised it. Okay, we have another one? Yes, ma'am.
We may have missed this earlier because we weren't here. Why did you get into the martial arts? Was it for self-defense or kind of a hobby? What got you there?
When my parents were divorced, I felt very like I had no control over anything that was happening in my life. And I wanted something. I had bullies at school that were, you know, intimidating me. I had girls that I didn't want to be made to look like a fool in front of. And I thought, well, this offers all those. I mean, I'll have self-confidence, self-esteem. I won't be afraid of these bullies anymore. And I jumped in. But unfortunately, it had a cost. It had a cost.
So that probably happens to a lot of our kids.
It does.
Because we have a lot of divorces.
It does.
Single parents.
And it's not, you know, the martial arts was the way that the enemy used to get me. But there's lots of other ways that he uses to get other people. Right. You know, rock music, Hollywood, you know, video games, fashion, pride. So what we want to do is we want to show people that God's word is real, that he literally means what he says. Yes, ma'am.
My whole family believes in Buddha.
Yes, ma'am.
I got into those stuff a lot, and sometimes, you know, they wrote things on the wall to or whatever.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if you had any of that kind of experience.
I didn't have anything like that. The thing that caused me to realize how much more dangerous what I was involved with was, I was at the martial arts school one day. This was the last year that I was in martial arts. And I was there, and the classes had ended during the daytime, and I had a break, so I was going through paperwork, and the UPS man showed up, and he had a package for me. And so he came in, and I got out the checkbook and set it up on our counter, and He came up and told me the amount, and I started writing the check. And when I was writing the check, the only way I know how to describe it was, is I was writing the check, but it wasn't me writing it. I was watching my hand write the check, but I knew that my mind was not, I wasn't telling my hand to do what it was doing. It was signing my name, it was writing the check, and it was like I was in the back seat of the car and somebody else was driving. And then I heard my voice talking, what I thought was my voice, talking to the UPS man, and I felt something. It was like I could tell that something was wrong. And the moment that he left, you know, I didn't know what else to do except start calling out on the name of Jesus. And I was like, Lord, I need your help. I said, help me. I don't understand what just happened. It scared me. I was like, I don't understand what just happened. And that was when I started really looking for answers. And the first place I went was the scriptures. And the second place I went was Spirit of Prophecy, Ellen White's writings. And I started looking for answers. And I found answers. I found answers there. And I'm speaking, you know, specifically to Seventh-day Adventists. I found answers in Ellen White's writings that I wish somebody had shared with me years before. Detailed about what happens, how the evil spirits are fighting against us, and what power we have against them. We have all power. We have all power through Jesus. Do you care if I give you a suggestion? And this goes across the board, okay? We're a church that believes in the Old and the New Testament, right? Okay. Do you know that in the Old Testament it says the sins of the fathers can be passed to the sons unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me? What I have learned is that sometimes, because of what our ancestors may have been involved with, do you know that the Bible says it is a sin? It's a grievous sin, even under the New Testament, to eat blood. Did y'all know that? How many of us eat blood that's not kosher, or eat fish that's not kosher? I mean, I grew up as an Adventist. We ate tuna. That stuff wasn't kosher. Nobody, you know, treated that meat the way it was supposed to be treated. Do you know that the Bible literally says that we suffer for the consequence of disobeying God's instructions? So what I did, my mom's family is all from Honduras. I have no idea what kind of religious background they were involved in. But it's very simple. You don't have to go on a witch hunt, but what you do is you sit down before the Lord, kneel down, and you say, Lord, I confess all the sins of my ancestors. To the fifth generation back, I confess everything that they've done. I don't even need to know what it was. But because I'm your child, and you have told me I can come boldly to your throne, I confess their sins, all the sins of my ancestors, and I do this as the father of my house. I confess the sins of my family, just like Job did. And I say, by faith, I claim the shed blood of Jesus Christ over my family and myself. And you know what the Bible says? In Galatians chapter 3, this is a beautiful promise. Galatians chapter 3, listen to what he promised us. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. That's not one curse. If you read Deuteronomy, there's a whole list of blessings if you obey and curses if we disobey. A whole list. We don't have to go down that list. All we have to do is know this. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. So in my family, I did that. I said, Father, I don't know what my dad's family or what my mom's family were involved in. I don't know what my ancestors were involved in. Have you ever noticed that sometimes somebody will be struggling with bitterness and they go, his dad was the same way. As a matter of fact, his grandfather was the same way. Are these generational things that have been passed down that the enemy is trying to hold on to his rights? It's easy. It takes one prayer and believing that God will do exactly what he says. Father, you promised Christ has exhausted the curse, is what Ellen White said. He's exhausted the curse that belongs unto us, being made accursed for us. Father, your word says that. I claim that. It's done. You thank him and you get up and it's done. It's done. The moment that you believe.
You know, another thing is also that it isn't that God curses us or anything like that. As, like, for example, I was a generation of Catholics for far apart. And the thing is that finally I was the one who decided to read the Bible. And
amen. Amen. Amen.
And from then on, it's nothing but blessings. The turn, it's not the guys doing it. It's just unfortunate because of our ancestors has been so used to go over and over and over that we fall in the same trap.
No, yes, sir.
They say, well, it's good for my father, so it's good for me. So, you know,
that happens often.
He's a great guy, to be honest.
Ma'am, did you have a question? Okay. Do you have anybody else? Okay. Well, I appreciate y'all being so patient today, and it's been a pleasure to be here and meet everybody. And hopefully I'll get to see you guys again.
Appreciate you sharing with us too. Thank you very much.
Well, you keep us in your prayers, and we're going to do the same thing for you all. And I've shared a couple of things with the Elder David, and there's a couple there that I know he will enjoy, and I want to give out